Good afternoon. I welcome you to this session. Today we will be discussing the characteristics of a centrifugal pump. Last class we discussed the head developed by a centrifugal pump and also discussed the phenomena slip in a centrifugal pump. Now last class you asked a pertinent question at the end, that whether by increasing the number of vanes we can reduce the phenomena slip. Yes, it's very correct that by increasing the number of vanes and by reducing the passage area, blade passage area, we can definitely reduce the phenomena slip. But the number of, but on the other hand, what happens is that with an increase in number of vanes, the frictional losses, that is the friction between the fluid and the blade surface, increases. So therefore, the number of vanes are decided in the compromise of the slip and the frictional losses, because both of them are detrimental from the head develop point of view, because both slip and the frictional losses reduce the head developed by the pump. So today we will be discussing the characteristics of a centrifugal pump. What is meant by characteristics or performance characteristics? That is the performance of a pump. Now the performance of a pump or the characteristics of a pump are described or is usually described by its relation between the head developed and the flow rate at a given rotational speed. As you have noted earlier, that the specific speed of a pump is characterized by the rotational speed, flow rate and the head developed, N, Q and H. So therefore, these three quantities are very important performance parameters, and the relationship between head developed with the flow rate at a given rotational speed is usually referred to as the characteristic curve or the characteristic of a centrifugal pump. So today we will discuss that. Let us first see that if you recall the diagram, the velocity triangle for a pump impeller, as we have seen that this is moving like this. This is a typical blade. If you recall this diagram, well, if you recall this diagram, that this is that the blade outlet, this is the VR2, this is the blade speed at the outlet, and this is the absolute velocity. So this angle is the blade angle with the tangent, that means this angle with the tangent, this is beta 2, well, and this is alpha 2, that is the angle the absolute velocity makes with the tangential direction. So this velocity component is VF2, flow velocity, that is the radial velocity at the outlet. Now we see that the head, theoretical head developed is VW2 U2. This we have proved. This is because the VW1 is 0. The inlet velocity triangle is such that it gives 0 wheeling velocity, 0 wheel velocity, so that this is the net head imparted by the rotor to the fluid. And under theoretical conditions, that means if we consider the fluid to be inviscid and in the absence of slip, this is the head developed by the pump. That means this is a theoretical head. That means fluid is considered to be inviscid, along with that the phenomena of slip is absent. Well, so now from the trigonometric relationship, from this outlet velocity triangle, we can write which one is then V2, VW2. This is VW2 and this is U2. This is U2. This is the symbol U2 in this direction, velocity triangle. This is U2. This is VW2. So we can write VW2 is U2 minus this part. So from simple trigonometric relation, we can write this is VF2. VF2 is the flow velocity. That is the radial component of velocity. In this case, this is, we can write as VF2 cot beta 2 in terms of VF2, this one. VF2 cot beta 2. That means this part is VF2 cot beta 2, which is subtracted from U2, we get the VW2. That means the wheeling component of velocity at the outlet. Now, pump, for a pump,
moving with a rotational speed n, we can write this u2 is pi dn, the relationship between the linear speed and the rotational speed, where n is the revolutionary speed, rotational speed, with the same unit of time. For example, it is revolution per second, so u will be per second, meter per second. D is the diameter of the impeller, which is the outlet diameter. That means the diameter of the impeller at the tip of the blade, which is usually referred to as the diameter of the impeller. So, henceforth, whenever we will come across with this terminology, diameter of the impeller, we will mean that it is the diameter at the blade tip, that is the outlet diameter, pi dn. Now, Vf2, that flow velocity, can be expressed in terms of the volumetric flow rate through the impeller divided by the cross sectional area A. Well, this cross sectional area is the area normal to this flow velocity. In fact, this is equal to pi d into B, where B is the width of the impeller at the outlet, width, that means perpendicular direction, this direction, the width, pi d into width is the perpendicular area, that means the area perpendicular to the flow velocity, cross sectional area. We simply, A is equal to, we simply denote it by A. So, this is the cross sectional area of flow, Q by A is Vf2, all right. So, if you substitute this, we will get Vw2 is what? Pi dn minus Q by A cot beta 2. Well, therefore, we get H theoretical is equal to Vw2 U2 by G. That means we can write 1 by G Vw2 U2. U2 is pi dn, that means pi dn into pi dn minus q by a cot beta 2, all right, Vw2 u2 by g. So, this can be written as the same expression, here I write h theoretical is equal to pi square d square n square by g minus q into pi dn divided by g into a cot beta 2, rather this q I write here, this into q. Okay. Now, for a pump of a particular design and moving with a rotational speed n, fixed RPM n, revolutionary speed n, this quantity is constant, pi d square n square g, the pi d n g a are constant because the dimensions are fixed, the diameter of the impeller, the cross sectional area of the flow at outlet, the angle of the blade at outlet, all are fixed. So, it can be written as k 1 minus, so this can be expressed as this, where this is k 1, k 1 is equal to this quantity, pi square d square n square by g, and k 2 is equal to this quantity, pi d n by, which means this includes the geometrical parameters and the rotational speed of the impeller. So, we see that the head discharge relationship can be expressed as this, the head developed, theoretical head developed is some constant, that is a linear relationship k 2 k 1 minus k 2 q. So, this can be expressed in a figure like this. This is q and this is h. So, this can be expressed like this, theoretical head, that is h theoretical. That means K1 minus K2 cube, this expression, K1 minus K2. Now, the actual head developed, now due to slip, this head will be reduced by the factor sigma into H theoretical. That if you take care of the slip, then H will be H theoretical into the slip factor sigma. If we take care of the slip only, that means we consider the inviscid fluid, but at the same time we consider the slip phenomena, which is also taking place for inviscid fluid. And this value of this slip factor changes with flow, and in fact this decreases with increasing flow rate. That means the phenomena of slip becomes more prominent with increasing flow. If we multiply this and find the head developed, or we correct the head in consideration of the slip phenomena, I just draw it with this dotted one. This is the card, which is H is equal to H theoretical times sigma, which means that this represents the 1 minus sigma into H theoretical. That means this is the loss in the head developed due to loss in H, that is head developed, loss in theoretical head developed due to slip. This is this. So you can draw this curve. Slip factor decreases with increase in flow rate. Now we have to take care of frictional losses and other losses. So there are two types of major losses that take place. This can be written like that. One is the shock loss. Shock loss at entry. And another is the usual friction loss. Usual friction loss. Both the things are due to the viscosity of the fluid, due to fluid viscosity, which means that if the fluid viscosity is 0, both the losses cannot take place. But the cause of the shock loss at entry is different from that due to frictional loss. Now, we have seen that the fluid, the design of the blade is made in such a way that at design condition, the fluid glides the blade at the inlet. That means the angle of the fluid at the inlet relative to the blade becomes equal to the angle of the blade at the inlet with respect to any specified direction. The direction is tangential direction, direction along the tangent at that point. That means the blade angle at the inlet equals to the angle of the relative velocity of the fluid at the inlet, which means that fluid smoothly glides over the blade. But when pump works at a condition rather than the design conditions, or because of some altered conditions of flow, it may so happen that the fluid may not strike or may not touch the blade at the inlet with the angle of the blade at the inlet. That means the inlet angle of the relative velocity of the fluid will be different from that of the blade angle at inlet, which means the fluid obliquely hits the blade, for which there are losses. These losses takes place because of formation of eddies. The change in the direction of the flow velocity takes place, for which the eddies are formed. And these eddies cause a loss in mechanical energy, or a conversion of mechanical energy into the intermolecular energy. So fluid viscosity is the agent of curtailing the mechanical energy due to this phenomena, the loss taking place. A loss taking place because of a change in the direction of the relative velocity from the angle at the inlet, from the angle of the blade at the inlet. But this cause of change in the workhead, or conversion of a part of the workhead into the intermolecular energy, which we think as a loss, is due to the fluid viscosity. So therefore, fluid viscosity is responsible for this loss. That means for a real fluid, if the entry angle of the fluid, that means the fluid with respect to the blade, that means relative velocity of the fluid, differs from that at the inlet angle of the blade, fluid cannot enter smoothly along the blade, cannot glide along the blade, for which this type of losses take place. This is known as shock loss. Another loss is the usual friction loss. Now, this shock loss can be expressed as this. If we write this shock loss, that is the loss of head rather I write HS, the shock. HS is the shock loss or is full shock. This is expressed as some constant K3 can be expressed as Q minus QD whole square. Now, why it is expressed like this, where K3 is a constant, Q is the flow rate through the impeller and QD is the flow rate at the design condition. That means at the design condition, the fluid enters with the same angle of the blade at the inlet, that glides along the blade, for which the shock loss is 0. So, when Q is equal to QD, this is 0. But on either side of the QD, that means when the flow is lower than the flow at design point, design condition, or even greater than that, the shock losses increases. So, therefore, this is expressed as a index 2, as a Q minus QD to the power 2, this type of functional relationship occurs. Now, friction loss, now this we can show like this in this graph. This curve. This curve represents, therefore, let this curve we give the name 3, let this curve we give name 2, let this. So, this is the HF, H shock. So, this is the magnitude for a given flow rate of the shock, head loss due to H shock. This is 0 when Q is equal to QD. On either side of this QD, this increases. Now, come to the frictional loss. Well, what is frictional loss? Frictional loss is the usual viscosity phenomena between the fluid friction at the solid surface, as you know, for which even for the flow of a fluid through a fixed duct, we get the pressure loss. So, this is simply the frictional loss. This is due to the viscosity of the fluid, friction between the fluid layer and the solid surface and between layer to layer of the fluid. So, this is usual frictional loss associated with the flow of fluid through a solid duct, which can be expressed in terms of the square of the flow rate. This is an usual information very known to you, that the loss in energy due to fluid viscosity is proportional to the square of the velocity when the flow is in the turbulent region. You have seen that, that the pressure drop is proportional to the square of the velocity. So, frictional loss in head due to loss in head due to friction is proportional to the flow velocity or the proportional to the flow rate square, proportional to the square of the flow velocity or the square of the flow rate in the turbulent region of flow. And in all fluid machines, the flow is in the turbulent region, so it can be expressed as a constant K4 times the square of the flow rate. So, this can be shown like this. This curve is, let 4, curve 4, curve 4 is HF. It is parabolic, it is not straight, not at all straight. I am very sorry. Just my drawing says like that, it is definitely parabolic. Parabola whose vertex is at the origin, very good. It is not at all straight, it looks like that, it is a parabola. That means at any Q, this is the value of HF. Good, it is parabola, definitely. HF is K4Q square, Y is KX square, where Y is the ordinate and X is the typical parabola. Very good. Now, if we deduct these two losses, that means HF plus H shock from this head, that means from H theory into this, we get a curve. If you just deduct this, we get a curve like this. This is 0. We get a curve. This curve is the, sorry, this curve is the, This is the actual curve. Sorry, this will be here because this will touch. I am sorry. So this will be this will be little bit this part you take. This is the curve 5. So this is the actual head HA. So this is the hydraulic loss. So, this is the hydraulic loss, This is the hydraulic loss.
Sir, at origin both
Yes, it may not touch. It may not touch. Here it looks like this. It may not touch. So this, what is done is that sum of this plus this is deducted from this point, deducted from this curve. The ordinate of the four, curve 4, again I am telling, and curve 3, the sum of the ordinates of curve 3 and curve 4 is deducted from the ordinate of curve 2. Then we construct this curve. That means HA is, I write this thing, this will be clear, HA is sigma H theoretical, which is the ordinate of the curve 2 at any point, minus H sharp, well, minus HF. It looks like that. It is because it, if I draw it here, then I cannot show the hydraulic loss. That's why I made it like that. It is, it appears to be at the same point. Not necessarily. It depends upon the relative magnitude of all these things. So ultimately, this is converted to a curve like that, which gives the actual head versus discharge curve. This is the qualitative train. These are all qualitative trains. All right. Now next, I will discuss the effects of blade velocity on HQ characteristics, effect of blade outlet angle beta 2 on HQ characteristics. H here means the actual head characteristic, HQ characteristic. Now let us see this diagram, if you can see it. I think this is done in an exaggerated way. Before that, I tell you that depending upon the outlet angle of the blade settings are categorized in three distinct way. One is forward curved. These are the terminologies you must know. Forward curved blade or vane, blades or vanes. Another is the radial blades or vanes. Another is backward curved blades or vanes. Depending upon the outlet angle, the setting of the blades can be categorized in three categories. One is the forward curved blades, radial blades, and backward curved blades. You see that what are meant by that. Now, in the setting of forward curved blades are those blades. This is forward curved. That means the curvature is in the direction of the rotation. That means the blade curvature is in the direction of the rotation. This is radial. That means the blade becomes radial almost. Initially there is little curvature, but finally towards the outlet blade is radial. And this is the backward curved vanes or blades. One blade or one vane is shown, where the curvature is in the opposite direction to the direction of the rotation. This is forward curved blade setting. This is the radial blade setting. This is the backward curved blade. So difference is there only in the velocity triangles, shape of the velocity triangles. In this case, the velocity triangle takes this shape. You can see this thing. This is the VR2, which under design condition should match the blade outlet angle. This is beta2. This is beta2. This is the absolute velocity V2. This is U2. In this case, the tangential component of velocity at the outlet is more than the blade velocity at the outlet. And this angle beta 2, this is the same angle with the tangent, that means this angle, is greater than 90 degree. That means obtuse angle beta 2 is greater than 90 degree. Here beta 2 is 90 degree. Obviously, at design condition, the relative velocity angle with the tangent, direction of the tangent is same as that of the blade at outlet. Blade is radial, that means the beta 2 is 90 degree. So VR2 makes 90 degree with U2. So we get a right angle triangle as the velocity triangle at the outlet. In this case, which is the usual case, which we have already discussed, this velocity triangle we drew earlier with reference to impeller blade, where beta 2 is less than 90 degree. That means, it is a backward curved vane. The curvature of the vane or blade is in the opposite direction to the direction of the rotation. So, this is Vr2, this is U2, this is V2. Here the tangential component of velocity at the outlet is same as that of the blade velocity at the outlet. In this case, it is more than the blade velocity of the outlet. In case of radial blade, it is equal to the blade velocity of the outlet and it is less than the blade velocity at the outlet. This is U2, this is V2. I am sorry, hurriedly I did it. You are very correct, very good. This is a drawback, doing it earlier. Vw2, okay, fine. So, in this case, Vw2 is greater than U2. In this case, Vw2 is U2, very good. In this case, Vw2 is less than U2, very good. I thought that something is going to happen, that your face tells like that, correct, Vw2. So, therefore, if you see the general relationship that H theoretical, where we develop this expression, is K1 minus, if I express in this way, K2 into Q. What is K2? If you just go through that, this K2 was this quantity called beta 2. So, when beta 2 is less than 90, it is positive. When beta 2 is greater than 90, this K2 is negative automatically, depending upon the sign of cot beta 2. So, therefore, depending upon whether the beta 2 is more than 90 or less than 90. So, therefore, in this case, K2 is less than 0. So, automatically, this will be plus. In this case, K2 is 0 and in this case, K2 is greater than 0. So, therefore, it is for the backward curved vane, we get a linear curve with a negative slope, sloping downwards. That means, if we now draw this, the theoretical head simply, only the theoretical head versus the Q, we will see that this is for radial blade. Radial blade, K2 is 0, K2 is 0, all right. So, this is K1. So, radial blade, H theoretical, which is independent of the flow rate. This increases with the flow rate with a positive slope. This is, there K2 is 0. Rather, first I write beta 2 is 90 degree and K2 is 0. This is radial. This is forward curved. In this case, this formula, this K2 is negative. That means, beta 2 is greater than 90 degree and K2 is less than 0, because in the actual equation H theoretical is K1 minus. If I describe this as K1 minus K2, here K2 is less than 0, automatically it becomes plus. And this is the backward curved vane, backward curved, in which case beta 2 is less than 90 degree and K2 is greater than 0. So, automatically it is giving a negative slope. Now, if the losses, slip and other losses, that is the shock loss and the frictional loss, are taken into account, these curves also revert to their actual counterparts that I just show you. This is the basic thing, that theoretical curve will take this shape, this will ultimately come to this shape. See that this is the, these three, the pink color, for this is for H and these are for power, that I will come afterward. Now, this is for backward, this one is for radial, and there is the little change, like this one is called forward. So, forward curve, when there is the little increase with HQ characteristics initially, then it is followed by a negative slope. Same is that for a radial, but for a backward curve, when it is always with a negative slope. Now, Similarly, if we plot the power versus Q, that is the power requirement, but this depends upon the overall efficiency of the pump. So it has been found from the tests on pumps, the power versus flow rate curves are like this. For a forward curved blade, the power goes on increasing monotonically. Initially, the rate of increase is slow, then it goes on increasing. For a radial one, it is almost linear. That means it is gradual, continuous, monotonic and gradual increase with the increase in flow rate. While the most interesting part is that the power attains a maximum value, and that means that it increases with an increase in flow rate and then decreases. That means at a given flow rate, it attains the maximum value. And usually, it has been found that this maximum power, that means this point corresponding to this flow, is associated with the design point and the maximum efficiency in case of backward curved vane. So this maximum power point is associated with the maximum efficiency of the backward curved vane. Now in this relation, I like to tell you a very important thing which sometimes you may be asked, that in case of backward curved vane, you see that the when the flow rate changes from its design value, the power required becomes lower. Therefore, if a motor is used to drive the pump at any condition other than the design condition, that means if it drives the pump at part load, then what will happen? That it can be, if it is rated at the design condition, then it can be safely used, that for the part load, the power is decreased. That means a motor rated for the design condition can be used for this backward curved vane, because at part load, the power is automatically decreasing on both the sides. This is known as self-limiting characteristics. Very important. This is there for the backward curved vane. But yes. That means if we use a motor for backward curved vane centrifugal pump, which is rated for the design condition, but if the motor, if the pump works at altered condition from the design condition, if by chance the flow rate is increased or decreased, that means at part load, when this pump is working on part load, then the motor can be used with a lower rating. But when the pump develops this maximum power at the design condition, the same pump can be used more safely, because this is rated at the design condition. You understand, that is a pump which is rated at design condition, when the pump can drive the pump safely at part load, because the power is less there, and automatically it can take care of the maximum power at the design condition. This is known as self-limiting characteristics. That means the pump can be safely used under altered conditions from the design condition. But what happened for other cases, forward and radial vane? For example, in the radial case, the power goes on increasing monotonically with the flow rate. So if a pump we select for a maximum power, for example, we know the design condition corresponds to this point on the power curve. Just an example. So when by chance the flow rate increases from that, so the power requirement will be more. So a motor rated at the design condition will be overloaded and the motor will fail. But if we take a motor, you understand, if we take a motor which is rated for the maximum power, then what will happen? The motor will be always underutilized, because pump will not be operating at the maximum power. So we will have to pay for the extra rating. But if you select a motor which will be of smaller size and rated at a smaller power, for example, the power may be, this is maybe the point where the design condition is there. That means the motor pump efficiency is maximum here, and we expect the pump will be running under this condition only. By chance the flow rate increases, so power will increase, so motor will fail. But if you take a motor which is rated at this very high power, that means we take a factor of safety, then we will see under almost all conditions the motor will be underrated. So therefore it is very difficult to choose, to have a choice or to choose on the motors from the economy side in case of radial and forward curved vanes. This is because in these two cases, the self-limiting characteristics is not there. This is because of this typical trend of variation of the power with the Q, which is there in case of backward curved vanes. So therefore, we choose always a backward curved vanes as the impeller vanes of a centrifugal pump. All right? Okay? So today I think up to this, next time we will proceed to pump and system characteristics. Thank you. Any query, please? Any query? You may ask, please. Any query? Okay, thank you.